How to bake the crucible? Well, first of all, you need to make sure that the printer has actually stopped working. And you can see that the fork is located at the home position and all four pourers are docked. Don't confuse it with the moment when the fork is under a pourer and it's at the docking station and it's just waiting for it to fill. It stays there for about like a minute or two when it's doing the final trace. So when all pourers are docked and the fork is at the home end position, then you can take out the crucible. Carefully put the filler metal pancake on top. The lid of this crucible does not have a perfect fit. So to minimize the air coming in, I'm using this stainless steel foil. I'm not sure if it's really necessary, but it definitely doesn't hurt. Put the crucible into the kiln. For this object I am printing, this one small pancake is not enough, so I need to add more. The total mass of the object is estimated in the preview screen in the slicer, so you can weigh the pancakes and make sure you have at least that amount. And here, for the last pancake, I am using the unused portion of the pancake I was using for the previous print. So if you put too many pancakes, you can reuse the unmelted part in the next print. Here I'm trying to close the lid carefully without driving the foil belt too deep into the sand, because if I do, it will distort the shape of the print. Now we need to add coke. Coke is a relatively pure and cheap form of carbon. It would react with the excess of oxygen in the crucible. If you add too much, that's not a problem, because you can reuse the coke, the unused unburned coke, next time. Some of the pieces of this coke, actually all of them, have been used previously. Each time you use a piece of coke in the crucible, it becomes smaller and smaller, so you'll have to add new pieces once in a while. Now we need to add more sand on the top to prevent distortion of the printed object. If we don't do it, the upper part of our object would be distorted because the metal is heavier than the sand, and it would try to flow below, and sand would be just like floating on top of molten metal. So that's why we need to add more sand to create like more friction between the particles. Probably any sand would work for this purpose, so I'm using the previously baked sand, slightly filtered. I'll show it a bit later how to filter it. Now we need to plug the top hole of the crucible with something. Here I'm using a ceramic disc. The tighter you plug all holes and cracks in the crucible, the less oxygen, the less air would get into the crucible, and the lower chance your printed object would get oxidized. Also, less coke would be burned, so more coke you'll be able to reuse for the next time. Now let's make sure we use the right program. So this program has 5 segments. The first segment has ramp 200 degrees and it goes up to 550 degrees C. The second segment goes slowly 100 degrees C ramp to 650 C. The reason why we need to go slow between 550 and 650 is because here we're using a clay crucible, so we need to go slow through the quartz inversion temperature. But after that we can go much faster. So the third segment is 600 degrees C per hour ramp, and the whole temperature is 1184 for two hours. So for 2 hours we bake it at 1184. The fourth segment we go down to 600 degrees C, also using 600 ramp, and we don't hold. The fifth segment we go slow with 100 degrees Celsius per hour ramp down to 500 degrees Celsius. Then we turn the kiln off. Okay, while I was talking about the segments, the kiln has already reached the temperature, well, with the help of video editing. While the kiln is running, even the outside gets pretty hot. Maybe it's not enough to burn a piece of paper, but I wouldn't touch it with my fingers. When it finished baking and cools down, let's unplug it and see what's inside. There are several ways how you can separate the part from the sand. The simplest one would be the wire brush. A wire brush in a drill would be faster. I think the fastest way to clean it would be to use a sandblaster, if you have it. By the way, if you're using a stainless steel crucible, you would not need to have that many segments, because stainless steel doesn't have any quartz inversion temperature. So you can go probably as fast as your kiln would allow to the maximum temperature. For the copper, I use 1184. It's just like 100 degrees more than its melting temperature. You probably could melt it at a lower temperature, and you might not even need to hold it for 2 hours at that temperature. And also, if your kiln shows some like specific temperature, it might be not quite precise, so you might need to experiment a little bit. So if you like use a lower temperature and it's like not working, then you can raise the temperature a little bit. So with copper I didn't actually play much. I just used 1184 and it worked, so I didn't bother trying to figure out the optimal temperature. So if you are using high carbon steel instead of copper, you would need to use a higher temperature, probably like something like 1250 C, and maybe holding it for 3 hours. And the larger your crucible, the longer hold time you would need, because it would take time for the heat to get inside the crucible. And here how we can filter the used sand to use it later for filling the lid of the crucible. If we want to print with the sand, we would need to filter it better. Let's clean our part some more with a power tool. I wish I would have a sandblaster as well. Okay, let's say it's clean enough. Let's cut off the runner. I see a lot of defects here caused by the oxygen from the infill metal from the copper pancake. I used it because I already had it, so it was free. But if I want to print a part without defects, I would have to use copper with low oxygen or like oxygen-free copper, which is more expensive. Well, hopefully this tutorial was helpful.